friends, my name is Dr. Dvalisa. So now our topic of the lecture is getting spastic cerebral palsy children. So this is very important. We are going to the we learn about the different type of spastic gait in the cerebral palsy children. So initially we learn about the something basic about the gait also, then we will correlate that gait with the spastic cerebral palsy patient children, and that even we will classify that spastic cerebral palsy children also, gait in the spastic cerebral palsy children. Okay, so we start. These are the with the contents. When we go to the introduction, we know what is cerebral palsy. It is non-progressive neurological disorders. Right, there are different types of cerebral palsy. Among them, 70% of the cerebral palsy children are spastic. 20% are the acidosis or dyskinetic CP, and 10% are the ataxic CP. Since 70% of the spastic CP, we have the spastic diaphagic CP, spastic hemiplegic CP, and spastic quadriplegic CP. Spastic diaphagic and spastic hemiplegic are the commonest one. This is normal patterns of the gait. We know the traditional term in the gait, stand phase divided into two and swing phase. As per the Rancho laws, Amajo's term, it is called stand phase and the swing phase. In that traditional term, we know the stand phase includes hip strike, foot flat, mid stance, heel off and toe off, where the swing phase, it is acceleration, mid swing and deceleration. As per the RLA term, stand phase includes initial contact, loading response, mid stance, terminal stance and pre swing. And the swing phase includes initial swing, mid swing and terminal swing. Now go to the details. So gait actually matures at the age of the 7 to 9 years of the children. In the children, if you compare between below 2 to 3 years, and if you compare the children with the older people in the gait wise, then in the children within 2 to 3 years, no full extension at the mid stance, and hip is little more abducted to provide the more base of support for the good balance. Even the old people, we find wide base of support. Even some tongue flexion is compensated to minimize the energy expenditure and to maximize the balance. So first we go to the kinematic of the gait. So in the kinematic, there are first is the phases of the gait cycle. There are the two phases, stand phase and the swing phase. The gait terminology, you already know that we go in detail now. And we have to assess the joint motion in sagittal plane about the joint angle and the frontal plane about the joint angle. So this is a stand phase. The traditional terminology we know, it is a heel strike. Okay. This is a foot flat. Okay. In the RLA terminology, it is called initial contact, it is called loading response. Mid stance, it is called the mid stance. It is a heel off, it is called the terminal stance. It is a toe off, it is called pre swing. When did a swing phase is acceleration, it is called initial swing. Mid swing, same mid swing. And deceleration in RLA also is called terminal swing. So if you go to the joint angle, okay, the joint motion will be seen in the sagittal plane during the stand phase. So if you see here in the initial contact, okay, there is a 0 degree movement in the ankle, the knee, and 20 plus degree of flexion from the hip joint. In the foot flat, there is a 10 degree of the plantar flexion, 15 degree of the knee flexion, and 15 degree of the hip flexion. In the mid stance, there is a 30 degree of the plantar flexion movement, that dorsiflexion occurs. In the mid stance, 5 degree of the flexion and 0 degree of the hip movement. When you go on to the heel on, heel off phase, there is a 0 degree movement. Here again is a 0 degree, but 10 to 20 degree of the hyperflexion at the hip joint. When you see the toe off phase, there is a 60 degree movement at the plantar flexion. There is a greater 60 degree of the phase, it is here. In this, the 20 degree of the plantar flexion, 30 degree of the knee flexion, and 10 to 20 of the hyperactions of the hip will be seen. In the acceleration phase, there will be a 10 degree of the plantar flexion, 60 degree of the knee flexion, and a 20 degree of the hip flexion occurs. In the mid swing, this is 0 degree of the ankle joint, 30 degree of the flexion of the knee, and 30 degree of the hip flexion. And last phase of the deceleration, the swing phase, 0 degree of the ankle and knee, and 30 degree of the flexion of the hip joint. If you see the kinetic of the gait, we have to cover three parts in that. First is the ground reaction force, which is opposite to the gravity. Next is the center of the pressure. And third is the international forces, which applies to the limb in order to maintain the balance in the gait movement. It will be seen the sagittal plane movement and the frontal plane movement. Go into details. This is the center of the pressure. When you are doing the initial contact, the center of pressure is over here, black dot. When you are doing the foot flat, that is the flat foot face, there is a center of pressure is here. Before the heel off, center of pressure is here. And before the toe off, the center of pressure shifts to here. So the internal external forces applied to the different phases of the gait. Okay, when there is an initial contact phase, okay, this is a ground reaction force vector. It occurs it is behind the ankle joint, front to the knee joint, and front passes to front to the hip joint. So opposite to the ground reaction force, it passes to the opposite to the joint. According to that, opposite muscles will work to maintain the contract the muscles and to maintain limb in a proper phase of the gait. So first initial contact, in this it is moving behind to the ankle, so the dorsiflexor movement is the flexor movement of the knee and the external movement of hip will occur. In the foot flat, it passes behind the ankle, so dorsiflexor movement behind the knee, therefore extensor movement, front to the hip, therefore the extensor movement of the hip will occur. In the mid stance, it passes here, the plantar flexor movement happen, flexor movement of the knee happen, and the flexor movement of the hip will occur in the mid stance. And the heel off phase, there will be, it passes very very front to the ankle joint, therefore more plantar flexor movement happens at the ankle, flexor movement of the knee, and the flexor movement of the hip will happen. And the last toe phase, we have the very much plantar flexor movement at the ankle, extensor movement at the knee, and the flexor movement at the hip. This is the way how the ground reaction force happens. Now there are different gates in the spastic diaphragic CP. Okay. First one is a two equinus gate. Second is the jump gate. Third is the apparent equinus gate. And fourth is the crouch gate. Okay. So in the first two equinus gate, we go to the each gate separately. So type one, it is a two ankle equinus gate. In this ankle equinus is a plantar flexor movement. You find here, knee is in full extension, mild recuratum, hip is extended fully, pelvis is normal, and anterior tilt same. Next, second type 2 gait, it is a jump gait. In this ankle equinus is seen, knee flexion in the early phase, stance phase, and the knee extension in the late stance phase, as well as the hip will be seen in flexion in early stance, whereas the hip will go into the extension in the late stance phase, and pelvic is normal or anterior slightly throughout the phase. Third one is the apparent equinus gait. In this, ankle is within the normal range of motion, but knee and the hip will be excessive flexion. Pelvic may be in the normal or anterior position. Type 4 gait in the spastic diaphragic, it is a crouch gait. In this, ankle will be in excessive dorsiflexion throughout the stance phase. Knee is in excessive flexion, as well as the hip also will be in excessive flexion, but pelvic will be in normal or the posterior tilted. Last type is the spastic diaphragic gait is symmetric gait. So it is in symmetric gait, individuals with the two limbs are classified into different groups of the 1 to 4 of the type what we discussed before. So example, it will be possible in the left leg it is a type 2 type of gait, and right leg it is maybe the type 3 type of gait. For example, here it is given the one leg, left leg it is maybe having the gait pattern of the jump gait, and right leg maybe having the gait pattern of the apparent equinus gait. So this is called type 5 asymmetrical gait in spastic diaphragic cerebral palsy children. Next is the scissoring gait. It results from the spasticity of the bilateral adductor muscles of the hip. One leg crosses over the other, which each step like crossing the blades of a scissor. It is called seasoning gait. Gait in spastic hemiplegic CP. In this, that is the first type, it is a foot drop type of gait. In this, ankle plantar flexion is seen during the swing due to the weakness of the anterior tibialis muscle. Type 2 gait in the spastic hemiplegic CP is a equinus gait. In this, ankle being equinus contracture may also have an equinovarus foot. Type 2A, with the neutral knee or the extended hip in the stance, and type 2B in the knee may be liquidatum in the stance. Type 3 gait in the spastic hemiplegic CP is a stiff knee gait. Here the true ankle equinus and the stiff knee gait limits the knee excursion throughout the gait, and also it limits the knee flexion during the swing. So it may be like a circumflexion type of gait. So in type 4 gait in spastic hemiplegic CP, it is a foot to pelvis involvement. Here, the ankle will be equinus position, knee will be stiff, hip will be flexion, internal rotation, and the adduction, pelvic will be anterior tilting, or hemipelvic retraction will be seen. This is a type 4 gait in spastic hemiplegic CP. So, if you go to the hemiplegic gait pattern, okay, with the spastic pattern of the hemiplegic gait CP child, hip will be in extension, adduction, medial rotation, knee in extension, often unstable, ankle is in a drop foot with the ankle plantar flexion, and inversion, it's called equinovarus also, which is present during the both stance and the swing phases. In order to clear the foot from the ground, hip and knee should flex in order to clear the ground. So this is all about that different types of gait we see in the spastic cerebellar palsy child. I hope you all understood about this. Thank you very much.